Hello and welcome to another exciting episode of Kaya Sport TV, or should I say, a special edition of Kaya Sport TV. And this is because we've got rugby and more rugby. And of course, all this in light of the Boks going up against the All Blacks in the semi-finals of the Rugby World Cup. Now, we saw this as a fitting opportunity to invite a former Bok coach, Peter de Villiers, into our studios to talk about transformation, the Curry Cup, as well as where rugby is going in the country. Now, he was joined on the panel by Kaunda Ntunja, who is a famous commentator, a rugby commentator. And of course, there was Lawrence Sephaka, a former Bok player. And they were being conducted by our very own John Perlman. Here's a look at what happened.
First of all, we say a very good evening to former Springbok coach Peter de Villiers. Peter, welcome. Thanks for giving us your time.
Thank you, John, for having me.
Former Springbok front row player Lawrence Sephaka, welcome to you.
Thank you, John. Nice to be up.
Rugby commentator at Supersport, Kaunda Ntunja, is with us as well. Kaunda, thanks very much for your time tonight.
Thanks, John, for having me, and good evening to all your listeners.
Lawrence, if we could turn to you and ask you this, what were the biggest obstacles that you faced coming up in rugby? And a second part to that question, has anything changed in the game for young black players since the time you were making your way?
For me, I think it was, first of all, I think the opportunity I got me sort of by surprise, but I didn't stop and pause. I took it with both hands, but I also later on understood what was given to me instead of a person who was already in the system, who were probably a better rugby player as well. I was young, and I was a person they could take their time with going forward. And that being said as well, I understood that I had to be, I had to really work hard, because I constantly had to prove my worth, because a lot of people, obviously skeptics, always thought I was there because of my color. I got an opportunity because of my color, but then I had to really compete with the guys that I was playing with. So nothing was different when we were training, nothing was different when we were playing. We did exactly the same thing.
What is that like? You say that there were people second-guessing you. Lawrence is in the team because he's black. That must be difficult, because so much of the game is played in your head, and it's a confidence game as much as a physical fitness game. Were there times when you thought, I'm sick of this question, I don't want to answer it anymore?
For me, it was not something new, because, I mean, the minute I got the opportunity, the sign to get involved into the game, I got the opportunity to actually leave my normal surroundings. I went to an African school, totally Africans. I had to change my language in order to fit in. So being the odd one out was never something new to me. So those critics were coming, but I knew where I was coming from, and that I came through the system with my peers that we were doing the same thing. I actually excelled at school level already, so that didn't bother me, but I knew. But also that helps a player is to make sure that you don't get involved in the media sphere. I mean, it's more now. Back then, it was just newspapers. So just don't read newspapers, and then you won't be disturbed by those comments, because some of them were ruthless. And I only focus on things that matter to me and the people that actually were personally involved in terms of, you know, encouraging or criticizing to help me go forward.
Peter, I was struck by Lawrence's phrase, I had to fit in. And I'm wondering, is that part of the problem, that this is still a game into which black people have to fit in? In other words, the game isn't changing and embracing the richness of its participants, but people must fit in? Do you have a view on that?
I think that is your outstanding obstacle, because when you have to fit in, you have to change completely who you are. So you don't even know yourself.
Yes.
You can't go out there and be yourself. You can't inspire anybody else. For him to fit in, he had to change everything that he were. So he never became a role model for his own people in this country, you know. And that is a sad thing in our country.
I want you to go back to the time when you were working with younger players, coaching an age group team to a World Cup triumph. Did you find yourself needing to work specifically with some of the younger black players on those kinds of issues? I mean, was that part of your conversations, or were you the coach and it was just tactics?
Well, Kaunda was one of those players that you're talking about here. And it's a privilege for me to be on the same show as him. No. From a very young age, I knew who I were.
Yes.
I never had any people or want people to tell me how good I am or how bad I always knew it, you know. And when I got the job, I was there to represent my country at a lower level or at any level. So the players must find leadership in me.
Yes.
They must see that I'm a mentor for them. And I have to take their lives into something that they badly want to become. So for me to try and change them, I actually asked them to be themselves.
Yes.
I actually was the one guy when people came to me and said, why do you allow the white players to sit at one table and the black players at another table? And I said, whoa. I want people to sit at the place where they are comfortable with each other and to be themselves, you know. So to me, I never treated them differently. And I have a very proud record with transformation. I've got a very proud record in giving them the opportunities. But what I told them is I will never give you opportunity that you didn't earn. And they were the best in the position that I played them in.
We're talking rugby transformation. Kaunda, you've been inside as a player, as Peter de Villiers was alluding. You're now watching the game, observing it closely, analysing it as someone leading the debates on Supersport. What's changed from the time when you were a young man focused on playing to what's happening now that you observe as a journalist?
Well, John, there's a lot more young black kids that are going to what was previously deemed as a Model C schools.
Yes.
And they're getting access to quality coaching, quality education from a very, very young age. And I think that helps with your transformation from a mental point of view and from a physical point of view as well. Don't forget that rugby is totally different to other sports in that your greatest tool in rugby is your body.
Yes.
So nutrition is vital. And when a lot of these kids that come from the rural areas or from the townships are grabbed from an early age and put into those environments, it actually does help them from a nutrition point of view and also from being able to blend in with other people from other demographics as well. So there's more and more of that coming into play now that in the 2000s, in this millennium, more of that coming into play. But having said that, guys that come from rural areas and go through the structures to get there, they should never be written off, because there's always a gem that always comes out from those situations. Guys like Jonge Kaya Nokwe, for example.
Yes.
He came from a very a poor background, and I mean, he scored 4 tries against the Wallabies at Ellis Park. So, I mean, those people are there, and they need to be catered for as well.
Peter de Villiers, one of the things that's come up in all the reports is that simply not enough South African schools in enough provinces offer rugby. How do we fix that? Is that because young people don't want to play rugby in those schools? What is it all about?
Let's go back to two things. The first one is, transformation is nothing to do about color.
Yes.
Transformation is a renewal of our minds.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a biblical thing. Comes from those years back. So if we can't renew our mind on things, then we will dwell on things that doesn't exist. And the one thing that doesn't exist in rugby is the culture.
Mm.
Because if blacks played it for more than 100 years and whites played it for more than 100 years, somebody actually came to take it and say, listen here, whoa. I'm going to hijack this now and make it my culture. So there's no culture in rugby. The only culture in rugby is that you must go out there and live the game, because the game nowadays is not a sport anymore. It's a lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
So you need to be inclusive in those things. You need to respect the lifestyle of other people too. You need to open it up for them. And one thing that we didn't get right, we had a guy called Vali Basson. He did Fasaru, he did a deeply investigation on transformation. And he said in 2006, the way that the game is growing and the blacks are getting to grips with the game, there's only going to be a few white players being left that will naturally play the game.
Yes.
And then what we had? We had the Wildeklaver tournament coming in to hijack that natural growth. We had the Varsity Cup coming in to hijack that natural growth. And now we come and we dwell on a little point like we're saying, there's not, we must go back to grassroots level. There's two things that I can agree with, and it doesn't add up. The one thing is, transformation doesn't add up with quotas. And we're taking our country backward if we're gonna dwell on quotas for the rest of our life. Because we're gonna take the hope that's been taken away from blacks already, we're gonna take it away from white boys, and then that's gonna be trouble for us.
I want to ask you about quotas in a bit more detail though, and go to a sport that isn't rugby. There was a view expressed that someone like Makai Ntini, if there was not political pressure for a young black player to be in the South African team, he might not have got the time and the chance he need, because cricket is a difficult game. Rugby is also a difficult game. But cricket, the margins are quite fine, whereas I think in rugby, you know, if you're not scrumming particularly well, you can tackle and you can make up for it in other ways. Many people argue that if Makai Ntini was not, there wasn't pressure to give him that chance, he would never have got it. Do you not see any value in that, Peter?
The only thing that I want is an opportunity to fail.
Mm.
Nobody gives us the opportunity to fail.
Mm.
And all of us, the Makai Ntinis, the Lawrence Parkers, you can go back on all those names. Whenever they got that one opportunity in life, they never failed.
Yes.
And because they never failed, people changed their minds. Whoa, now we must stop him.
Yes.
We expected him to fail, and he didn't fail. So now we stop him. And that is the bigger fight. The subtleness behind hiding things that doesn't exist.
Yes.
That is, to me, a bigger fight. Like you say, culture. There's no culture in sport. The only culture in sport is the culture that you create in the sport. I had a great culture in the Springboks. I went to study all the cultures of the country, and I respect everybody in the country. So what I did, I created a culture in my team. And that culture we built on principles. So everybody who came from a black background or a white background or a green or whatever yes. color background, they had to apply to the principles of how we as South Africans or as people need to behave ourselves when we represent our country at the highest level. And it worked for us. It really worked for us, because
yes.
if you don't fit into the culture, you don't fit into the team, because it's a team culture, not a country's culture.
Lawrence, I'm sure as people noted your success, saw you on TV, saw you as a role model, younger players, younger black players coming to you for advice. What were the most common questions that people asked of you, and what advice did you share?
An obvious question as to where did you come from. Most of the time I was either labeled as an Eastern Cape boy or KZN boy, because
yes.
Joburgers are well known for football.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously that one being put out there is like, you know what, I got an opportunity. Unexpectedly, I grabbed it with two hands. I didn't think as to how much I knew the game or how much I understood it.
Mm.
I just took it because it was better than the situation I was in. It meant it was going to propel me forward in my life in whichever way, and happened to be the positive way. I mean, like Coach said, it's an opportunity that every youngster needs to express himself out there, an opportunity not to be judged differently to another kind of player. I mean, every youngster must be judged the same. If you fail at that and then you get judged a certain way, the next one must be judged a certain way. What I get to pick up nowadays, you have to be the right kind of skin to be able to fail a couple of times. If you're the wrong kind of skin, you only got one chance. And you fail once, it's going to be a while again since you get that opportunity. Which hurts me a bit, because that's not how. I mean, you want to sell the game to kids.
Yes.
But then what do you tell them now? It's like, listen, I want you to play this game, but now, first, before you play the game, I want you to make sure this game must get you into places when you can better yourself as a person. Don't let the game become number one. You must become number one in your life, and then the game will actually naturally be successful as well. So when they ask me those kind of things as well, it's like, it's very important. I mean, a lot of parents now are complaining about, I mean, university situation at the moment. It's getting expensive. I had an opportunity to do it for free.
Yes.
Because of how I actually took the opportunity of rugby and use it in a different way. It doesn't have to be rugby. It can be any sport. Get opportunity, look after the opportunity to better yourself as a person.
I want to ask you, because Kaunda, a number of people are raising the TV thing, and Nico picks up on the earlier tweet that I read out and says, that TV point is right. Personally, I'd never have started watching rugby if the 1995 Rugby World Cup hadn't been shown on SABC TV. SuperSport, you're familiar with the criticisms that they've taken over the sports, and it's only access if you're able to afford it and pay for it. But you've been doing some things on SuperSport to try and make rugby more inclusive. How do you see this? Do you think that certain games should be on free-to-air TV? I'm putting you in a lot of trouble with your bosses.
Yeah,
right,
you're putting me in a corner, John.
But share with us what you guys are doing.
Yeah. Okay. Let's start off from the other side. SABC, they do air Springbok games, specifically the games that play here in South Africa. Even though it is delayed live, but still, they do play. If I'm not mistaken, they also play the Curry Cup final on SABC, probably delayed live as well. I'm not 100% sure about that, but
it's actually live.
Oh, congrats!
No, you can't delay. You can't delay it. The single game too.
Anyway, just from my side, you know, I think that my role at SuperSport, in terms of assisting in transformation, I think is very important. What I do at SuperSport is that I'm a closer commentator, and in what we found in since I've started doing Tosa commentary, which was in 2009 until now, more and more black people are interested in the game. There's more people that move from only having compact basically is football, and then they go to full bouquet because they're enjoying the Tosa commentary. And
so you're a money spinner.
Help them make more money, and also ladies as well, females, are more and more interested in the game because of my style of work. It's totally different to other languages, the style of commentary, and ladies actually do enjoy it, and it's a great way for guys and girls to be able to share in the experience together.
Let me ask you the question in broader terms rather than specifically about SuperSport, but thanks for sharing that with us. How important to the growth of the game is it that young people can watch it on TV? I mean, is that a major driving force, or is the real driving force a place where somebody can pick up a ball, find a coach, and actually start running with it?
Yeah, no, it is important. You know, Siakolisi comes from Zwide in PE, a township called Zwide, and obviously he is inspirational to two guys from there. And the more people that can watch Sia play, the more inspired they'll be to actually work hard to get there. And just something else, John, that you, I know I'm not exactly touching on what you're asking me. I feel sometimes we actually shoot ourselves in the foot when it comes to embracing transformation, because South Africa has got 55 to 60 million people. New Zealand has got what, about 2 million people that live in that country, if I'm not mistaken, something like that. They're the best in the world. Now, if we embraced everyone, every ethnic group in South Africa, New Zealand would never touch South Africa.
Yes.
If we embraced everyone and everyone was all inclusive, because the numbers, our numbers are far greater than theirs. And to be able to pick the best players using all of our resources, New Zealand would be going into this weekend's game as a heavy underdog.
Yeah. Well, one of our guests here at the Kai FM studios is Zola Ntlokoma. And Zola is the manager of the Soweto Rugby Union. Zola, welcome and thanks very much for joining us.
Good evening, John, and to the listeners at home.
What are the biggest obstacles holding rugby back in Soweto? What prevents the game from growing?
Actually, John, I didn't want to localize this and only speak about Soweto, because the kind of work that we do, some of us, it's national.
Okay. So townships in general?
Exactly. It's townships in general. Because if I give you a scope right now and say that in Val Triangle, there's nothing happening there. But when you go to government or you go to Lotto, people get reports, faked reports, according to us, to say that there's rugby existing in those kind of areas. You go to areas like Diepsloot, there's nothing happening. There was something happening with the big hotel sponsoring something there with a big union in Gauteng. all of that, it collapsed. People ran away with money. You go to areas like Alexander. In 2015, Alexander shut the shop. They closed the shop. There's no rugby club there. The following week, a rugby club in Kagiso, which is in the West Rand, they closed shop. Just after Alexander closed shop, you find that the teams in Pretoria, they get given 2,000 rands for the entire season to run.
Yes.
Others, they get given 5,000 rands to run. So I don't want to localize myself and speak only about Soweto. Now, the Dr. Fikeni spoke about the facility issues, and I would disagree with him and say facilities are there. Probably there's not enough capacity to capacitate our administrators who are administering the game to help them or assist them to say that how can they access those facilities or utilize those facilities. Because you find a situation whereby unions get given large sum of amounts of money by Lotto,
yes,
by SARU, by government. It's called for development. But is there any real development happening on the ground? It's none. But there's reports each and every end of the year that get sent to these structures who are distributing or dispersing these amounts of funds. Now, the stumbling block, what I want to say tonight is the stumbling block is not all these issues that we're busy discussing here. The real issue, the crux of the matter here, is not the EPG resolutions or recommendations, what Dr. Vili Pason have said. The real issue lies with the constitutions of these unions, whereby the white clubs have got 3 votes and black clubs have got 1 vote. And how are you going to transform? Because you can come up with all these nice strategies to talk about transformation. But if those constitutions are not changed, obviously you will have no black representation. You will only have black representation on co-option. And then when it comes to real matters, to vote or to sign off a team sheet that goes out on Saturday, you really, black people have no say, basically. It's only the sponsors and those big people who are elected by those 3 votes from the clubs who are really going to have a big say.
Zola, thank you. We'll come back to that. Peter de Villiers, a broader question. How do you get rugby into a community where the game perhaps doesn't have the deep roots that other communities have? Is it making it a mass-based game? Is it getting a player of excellence who becomes a role model? Is it a facilities issue? I mean, you've watched the game grow in some places and you've probably watched it die in others. Why have some succeeded and others failed?
Sadly to say, I think the government has a big role to play in this whole thing. They closed down all the colleges. Mm-hmm. And the students that went to colleges, it wasn't that expensive, but they went out and they took care of the children's welfare. They coached the children. There was enough coaches as teachers there. And nowadays there's no physical education in the school. The children doesn't get this kind of coaching at school. It's not part of their curriculum anymore.
Yes.
Everybody is just running away after school. Those who have the money and they can afford coaches. I mean, if you look at some of our rugby schools in the country, the coaches do earn more money than what most teachers do earn.
Right.
They are a very high income salary that they do have. So those are the things it's the interest that we took away.
Mm.
We took away the hope from our people to become something. Now, because there's no hope, now we can fight the little small things around it, like go back to grassroots level. If we allow people to give students under 13, under 18 contracts to go to bigger unions, for instance, you're killing the game down, because those little boys, they're the role models for everybody around them, because everybody wants to become like them. But now we take all the rugby talent out of our townships and nobody has a role model to become something. You don't even have a bar to sit so that you can become something. So what I'm trying to bring across is that we must do some introspection and say to ourselves, why are we selling ourselves? What we just heard about the unions, the votes that the guys have at the unions. If you look at the SARU unions that we had in Cape Town, for instance, at Western Province we had Tigerberg, mm-hmm. we had Western Province Board, Western Province, we had City and Suburban. All of them gave up their birthright. when there's now an occasion where they celebrate something, is the X, you know, the yes. 125 years, they never invite one of those black players who gave up so much. So people don't trust the system anymore. They don't trust anybody anymore because the hope that they had that things will get right is gone and it will never be fixed again.
Lawrence, in the break, you said you wanted to talk about TV. You had a little look out of the corner of your eye at Kaunda. So what is it you wanted to bring in?
No, I just wanted to give Kaunda a bit of a break because I understand the situation. I had an opportunity to go to France.
Mm-hmm.
A simple example, basically, I mean, club rugby there, it's club rugby, but it's run professionally. And what happens there, you've got paid TV, you've got national TV. And then with the paid TV, the local tournaments, the top 14 and whatever, Heineken Cup, those high-profile international competitions, you get paid for. But what impressed me more about the French is that when it came to national teams, not only rugby, no soccer, no cricket, even basketball, which is probably bigger in America than it is in France.
Yes.
It was a national team. It was on national TV. It was on free TV. That's exposure to someone who's never been exposed to the game. I mean, some of us who didn't grow up in a primary school where we played rugby only got the wind from TV from 95 as the things were taking off. I mean, it was sort of interesting. And that's another way of getting interest of someone who's never been exposed to something is way by interesting by what they see. And they get curious. Kids get curious. They want to try things. They don't know because they can see it's doable. How can I do that as well? I mean, and all of these other things. I mean, we've taken that away as well from the people who cannot afford private TV. And basically, it's, you know, those ones must match what they use to soccer all the time. Soccer is always on free TV. That's why you end up with a lot of black kids playing soccer. Not that they all want to play soccer, but that's all they know.
I want to bring in some young people now who are sitting in the audience with us. They're in their teens. They're rugby crazy. They're looking forward to making their way in the game. We've got a microphone there. If we could just get it across. I want to start there with Yanga Hlalu. Can you pass it along to Yanga? Yanga, hi, welcome. I believe you're at King Edward's under 16 playing rugby at the moment.
Hello. Yes, I am. I'm playing under 16 rugby for King Edwards.
And what position do you play in?
I'm a centre.
And how's it going?
It's going well, really well. I only just moved to centre, so I still work there.
How long have you been playing rugby, and what got you into the game?
I'm 16 now, and I started playing rugby when I was 10, so that makes it 6 years. So what got me playing is I was in, as they've said, a Model C primary school, and my coaches advocated that you get into sports and you do some physical activity because it was good for you. So naturally, like every other boy, I got into sports and I played some rugby.
And in terms of ambitions, is this something that you see as a career potentially, or is everyone saying, keep doing the maths?
No, definitely. I think every boy who steps onto a field has dreams of becoming professional one day.
And if you were to play professionally, what do you think is the route to doing that? I mean, do you have to focus just on rugby to make a success of that?
No, look, as some of our guests in the panel have said, you can use rugby as an avenue to get into university and study. So even if rugby doesn't work, one day you do have your degree to fall back on, and you can study and do whatever it is that you feel is good for you.
So you're at King Edward's famous rugby school. It's a very great South African sports school. Graham Smith went there. There was a Transvaal fly half who came from there, Lee Barnard, back in the, I think the 80s, I'm showing my age, probably 70s. Pass the microphone along. We've got Nick Kumalo sitting next to you. Nick, you're under 13. In the Vaal, where some people are saying rugby not as easy to get access to. Tell us about yourself, the position you play, and hold the mic nice and close.
Hello, I'm Nick. Yeah, I also play center. It's rugby in Vaal. It's not so easy, but I enjoy playing.
What got you into the game? Because so many people play football.
I just wanted to be fit because I'm not good at football. Yeah.
How did you know you were going to be good at rugby?
I just saw my friends playing. Then I thought that if they play, then I can.
And are you just playing at school, or is there a club structure? Is there some other rugby teams that you're able to join in the Vaal?
No, I'm just playing at school.
And in terms of school games, I mean, have you played representative rugby at all, or just for your school at the moment?
It's just for my school at the moment.
Okay. Ambitions?
Well, yeah, if I make it to the SA, that can be a dream come true for me.
That would be a dream come true indeed. That's the highest it gets. Pass the mic along. We've got a teammate of also from KES, Travis Gordon. Rugby, part of your life, all your life?
Yeah, rugby's been part of my life all my life. I started when I was under 9 at Tigers Rugby Club out there in the south of Johannesburg. And since then, I've just had the dream to make it one day and make it a profession. So
there's some people who are worried the school's rugby's too competitive, that it's taken too seriously, that young people should be playing for fun, but nothing more than that. What's your thoughts on that?
I think in the modern world, it has to be taken seriously. So you got to, like, you do have to start specializing in your sports because of the competition out there and the way the game is evolving. If you don't focus on a sport and you don't train hard enough for it, you're going to fall behind, and then you might not be able to make a career out of it one day.
I'm going to ask you this question. I'm then going to ask you to pass it back to Younger, your teammate. Do young players at your age notice whether a player is black or white? Is that an issue? Is it anything that comes up in the playing of the game?
Not in any of the sides I've played for. We all see each other as equals, and we all believe that all of us belong there. So once, like, there's no, oh, he's black, he's white. It's, we're all one team, you're good enough to be there, and we all back each other on the field.
I didn't ask you what position you play.
I'm an eighth man.
Okay, so you do pass the ball to the centre from time to time, because it's not the Springbok team where the ball never goes to the backs anyway. So can you pass the microphone along? Same question to you, Younger. Is race an issue at all?
No, not at all. I feel I'm one of the people who advocate the best players being selected, and I think for the sides I've played for, there's never been racial discrimination in terms of certain players saying no, he's there because he's black and he shouldn't get a certain number of minutes, because that's what it's coming down to in South Africa. It's how many minutes a black player gets. But for the teams I've played for, there hasn't been such situations.
Who inspires you when you see them on TV?
Siya Kolisi.
Okay, interesting. So now we come back to the TV question. And Peter, when I was saying TV revenue and money fuels development, you looked very meaningfully in my direction as if you had a view on that. Over to you.
I just want to go back to those three guys.
Yeah.
The only thing I see when I look at them and the way they talk, the passion that came through them, mm-hmm. and the one thing that stood out was dreams. So why would we shatter those people's dreams by putting in quotas in rugby? We will never realize if we take the hope away of people like that. You force them into gangsterism, you force them into drugs, you force them to bugger up your whole country. But if he understands that he lived his dream but he didn't make it to the top, he will still believe in himself and be still become the best he that it should be. I'm not naive here with we need revenue. But the one thing that we just walked over is that as soon as your sports becomes a corporate game, then they decide on whether we should take part in it or not.
Yes.
If the corporates don't like you, then you won't be part of the game. And the corporates make the decision for the decision makers. So they actually are a bunch of puppets running the game for the corporates. It's in anything. If corporates take over religion,
yes.
the churches won't provocate what they should do. And that's exactly what sport too. So what I would love to see, I would love us to sit down as South Africans and work out a merit system. What is merit for the game of rugby? Merit is not who's the best. No, that's not who's the best. That's an opinion.
Yes.
You know, merit is how can you do something? Come and look at the bigger boys. If they run into a smaller boy, they will make two meters on the contact line. I will never make it when I run into a big boy, mm-hmm. but he will never stop me. I'll step him and I'll still make the 2 meters.
Yes.
So if merit is, you have to make 2 meters where the contact line is and you make a plan to get there. If you can, then we can use you. You understand? But we never worked out a merit plan for rugby. We never worked out rugby principles. We never worked out what is our game situations in this country. We never worked out anything. So the opinion is now with the guy who's running the game at that moment, and his opinion become fact, and everybody must buy into his opinion as if it is gospel. So, what coaches to say to you is, let's stick to the principles of the game. And we don't understand what the principles of the game is at this moment in this country.
Lawrence, I want to talk to you a little bit about facilities. I mean, you can play football on a hard, dusty field. Rugby, particularly for people who maybe don't have the experience of playing the game, the idea of getting tackled on a gravel field is a little unattractive. Although, Kaunda, I'm sure you had some of that experience in growing up in the Eastern Cape. Is it critical that we invest heavily in playing fields, or do we have enough, in your opinion?
I think the facilities, like Zola has said, they are there. I mean, municipal fields are there for the public to use, and they're ever ready to be used by the public. But the problem is now getting the players to get there, getting motivated to get there, or creating an environment for them to actually want to go there. It's actually one of the problems as well. I mean, these youngsters, are also was listening. None of them has actually said, I'm playing this game because it's fun to play. I enjoy playing it. They're playing it because they want to do sport. They want to do well. They want to be physically well-groomed.
Yes.
I mean, it's a one way of staying, you know, disciplined. But like coaches said, I mean, in rugby nowadays, I mean, I grew up in a system where there's criteria to playing rugby in terms of your positioning, what is required in a certain position to excel. But that criteria only applies, like I said, only based on opinion of the coach at the time. But like I said as well, if there was criteria for players to be selected according, if for instance you're a winger, you have to meet this certain speed, this agility, this passing skill.
Yes.
If you can't do any of those before I select you, you can't do those simple tests, then you're not in a stage to be even considered. No, obviously if you notice on a rugby field, you select a player because you see what he can do or what the capabilities are. But then when you look closer, you find some weaknesses as well. Is it things that you can fix? Is it actually things that need special attention? But I mean, you wouldn't pick up someone who can't pass a ball to start with. But now when you select a team to actually represent the country, shouldn't they be the best in every position?
I want you to pass the mic to Kaunda. He lost his mic in a mall, and it ended up on the other side of the room. I want you to sell the game to an audience in Gauteng. Not as many young black boys and girls play rugby as would be desirable. And some of them look at the game and say, this looks great, but it's a good idea for somebody else. It doesn't appeal to me. Sell the game. Tell them why they should play.
In the late 80s, before I went to a school called Dell College in King Williamstown, I was in a black school called New Horizon in Butterworth. There was only soccer.
Okay.
Now, I'm a portly gentleman, and I was still then as a youngster, and I was told then, uinkomo, so you're a cow.
Yes.
Or you're a bull.
Yeah.
You must go to the polls. I never got a chance to play in the field because of my shape.
Yes.
Then.
And also
talking
because
about
of
football
a
now.
Stupid coach, I have to say. Limiting your ambition.
So when I, my father, who worked very hard, my father came from a very poor background. He worked very hard to make sure that I don't grow up in a similar background. I come from a middle-class family. Now, I went to Dell College, got there, and my size was embraced. When I got there, like, you are the guy that we want. And they
How old were you by then?
I was 10 years old.
Okay.
Yeah, and I was 10 years old when I arrived.
And they're already, you've got a lap of honor
going,
and they saw
and
you
my
arrive.
Size was embraced.
Yes.
I played prop then. Later on in life, I played flank, and then now I'm a prop again. But anyway, it's full circle.
Life goes
now. Wrong. Now, John, rugby is a sport for all shapes and sizes.
Yes,
rugby is also not a sport which is very expensive to play. You don't need a whole lot of equipment like cricket bats and gloves and all of that. especially when you're at junior school. When I was in junior school, we played barefoot. I don't know if things have changed now.
Mm-hmm.
And you needed a rugby jersey and shorts.
Yes.
And then Latvai, you go on. It is a physical sport, I agree. Some mothers might not be happy with that.
Yes.
My mother told me that I must play tennis when I arrived at Dale.
Okay.
And when I got there, my mate said, no, let's go to rugby. There's no tennis here.
Yeah.
And I enjoyed it. You know, it's rugby is truly a sport that can be enjoyed by all.
Okay, rugby can be enjoyed by all shapes and sizes. Well, you spoke about parents. Let's chat a little bit to Nick Kumalo's parents from the Vol. Nick, you remember, under 13, plays centre, enjoying the game, hoping to become a Springbok one day. And Nick Senior is his dad. So let's start with you. What are your thoughts about the opportunities your son is getting in rugby? Are they adequate? If there are shortfalls, what are those? Nick, over to you.
No, thank you. Yeah, okay, he's playing very well, and mm-hmm. Collectively as a team, they're doing very well. Actually, they've won 3 successive years.
Okay.
Cups, I think he has got over 6 golden, you know, medals that the school.
6,
that,
Nick?
I don't know.
He's nodding.
More.
Okay, Nick Junior's nods. 6 medals, that's pretty good going.
Yeah, it's a lot. They win, they go Kronstadt, Magaliesberg, Val, Meyerton.
Yes.
They are known, all, their school is known all over.
And,
okay.
And the name of the school, let's give them credit.
It's Hendrik van der Bijl.
Okay.
Hendrik van der Bijl Higher School. But having beaten all the schools in 3 successive years, then there is this union called Falcons and so on, you know,
mm-hmm.
where they do selections from different schools and make squad, they, you know, from they compete region to region. They will hardly have one boy selected who also doesn't go far.
Yes.
You know, that has been a kind of a prevailing, you know, culture that we wouldn't understand what happens when it comes to those, you know, structures. The very same schools that they beat.
Yes.
They play number of games and they win, but when it comes to selections where now you will expect as a parent that there will be, you know, opportunities, there's been one and the same boy and it doesn't go far.
Yeah.
And then it disappears. No, we are told there are some, you know, structures and criteria not met, you know, different criteria.
But you don't feel you get a proper explanation?
No, definitely no. You know, you'll ordinary. Let's take like sport. Where is Barcelona? When Barcelona is beating, is winning UEFA Cup, you'll ordinarily expect at least a couple of boys to represent them in Spain.
To represent Spain, yeah. And at the World Cup, I think it was 8.
But yeah, exactly. If there is none every year, there is none in the school that takes the cups every time. Beating or mooring the hell out of all the best schools there.
Okay. I want you to pass it on to Nick's mom. Lizzie, are you happy to join us? Hold the mic nice and close. Thank you. First of all, as a mother, I mean, when Nick Jr. said rugby's my game, what were your thoughts?
Yo,
that doesn't sound promising.
I didn't like it at first because I saw that maybe he's going to break his neck or his leg, or I didn't like it because it's too physical.
And now, it is a physical game. It's a game in which you can certainly get bruised, but do you feel comfortable? Are you excited to go to the game without a worry in your head that your son's going to come off on a stretcher?
Yeah, I do go to his matches every time. I'm actually the only mom who's attending the games.
The games, yeah.
I'm just supportive. I really like it, and I like it when he plays.
I've heard that one of the biggest problems of being a mother, or in fact the parents of a rugby player, is that your food bill increases enormously.
Oh,
that
too
they
much.
They come home and they eat not only everything you've put out for them, but if you're not careful, they eat all your food as well.
Yeah, he's always very hungry. Very hungry.
But I've heard there's a positive side.
Yeah.
After eating all that food, they tend to fall asleep.
No, he doesn't sleep.
Oh, really? Okay.
No.
Okay, so it's working a little bit, and it's in some ways it's not working in others. What would you like to see change in schools rugby? I mean, we heard your husband, Nick's dad, talk a little bit about being unclear about who gets the opportunities to play at a higher level? What if anything, are your thoughts on that?
I just wish that maybe those structures, they can just select our kids, because when you go to the games, you just see, okay, maybe there are three black boys or four in two teams that they are playing there. Then maybe they will select only one team from those, and not even a single of us. Even in the field when they are playing, because our boys are from English speaking schools,
right?
And the coaches are speaking in Afrikaans with our kids. Sometimes they miss it somewhere, and then even the mates, they are Afrikaans speaking. So it's not that easy, I think, for them. But I wish they can get that opportunity one day.
And as it gets bigger and gets closer to being a Springbok, you know what's going to happen to that food bill.
Yeah.
Okay, I want to start talking, we'll come back to the transformation issues, but I do want to focus a little bit about Saturday's game. And Peter, you had a successful record against the All Blacks. You did very, very well. Lost some, but won more than you lost. What is it about playing the All Blacks that is different? Is it, and indeed, is it different, or did you say to your players, just another game?
Well, there's a few things that they can do Saturday. The first thing I did is I gave them my players a free reins. You put on the jersey of the team that you want to play against.
Yes.
And then see them as those kind of players. Mm-hmm. So you don't look at them and you're not in awe of them. That's number one. Number two, they are the worst defensive side in world rugby. Hmm. Although their structures are very, very good, they're not executing it very, very good because they've got an attacking mindset.
Yes.
So if we can go out on Saturday, and that is what I will think the coach should have said to them, go defend that source. Don't give them line-out ball. Don't give them scrum ball. Put it on the back foot of them. Cut down the space then down at the centers because of the fact that they're going backward at source. They don't like you. In their faces. If I can recall the game that we won in Hamilton to cleanse the Tri Nations, we actually did just that. We knew that they would come out. Well, we were lucky that we got some penalties and could lead the game and then shut down their spaces, so force them into errors and go further ahead. And that's the only way that we can go do it on Saturday. Otherwise, going
to
be tough.
Am I right in remembering that Hamilton game as a couple of turnover tries? Was that a feature of the game?
No, we didn't score a lot of tries in that game. Mm-hmm. There was not a lot of tries in that game itself. I don't think you talk about the Dunedin game.
Okay.
Yeah, but the Hamilton game when we clinched the Tri Nations, we just put the pressure on them. We cut down their spaces. That big names that they had in that game became smaller and smaller and smaller as the game went on. But the one thing that I went in that mindset, the way we are as black people, we will respect you, but we're not in awe of you.
Yes.
So whatever we can take from you, we'll take it with interest, and we give nothing back to you, you know? Mm. And when we see a long face after the game, we smile because of your long face.
Okay. Kaunda, you want to?
Yeah, I just want to touch on 2009 when the coach here was quite successful against the All Blacks. What I remember clearly about that Tri-Nation series, and Peter, please coach, stop me when I'm off. The All Black wingers were Sitiveni Sivivatu and Joe Rokothoko.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Now, we were able to exploit their weaknesses in that whole series, mm-hmm. in that they're very good attacking players, but they were very slow at turning and chasing balls, mm-hmm. which are kicked behind them. And they weren't always the best under the high ball. Now we were able to exploit an opponent's weakness. Now, I fear that with this squad here, we are obviously adamant about our strengths and our weaknesses, but we struggle to exploit the opponent's weaknesses. And I think that is something that that really bothers me. Like, for example, we played against Japan and we lost the game against Japan. Now, the Japanese knew that they couldn't match us physically. So they did things in the game to sort of stunt our strengths. And unfortunately, I don't know if it was a situation whereby we overestimated our abilities and underestimated them, but
yes.
We weren't able to exploit their weaknesses. I'll make an example, a line out. They have a line out 5 meters from our try line. We've got Yanni, we've got Beast, we've got all the big boys there, and we know we're gonna counter shove them. They throw the ball to the middle.
Mm.
We all go rushing. Then they just do a shift drive. And then they shove. And yeah. By the time we realize that they've done a shift drive, it's too late. Michael Leach has gone and scored. It's a scrum. And our guys are primed to shove them off their feet. They just do a channel one ball. It's a second, 2 seconds. The ball's ready at the at the number eight. So it's just small things, John, that bother me with this squad, in that we struggle to exploit the opponent's weaknesses.
And,
okay.
and can we go back to that, the weaknesses and the strengths? Because the All Blacks' strengths then were putting themselves, creating momentum going forward. But we got Heinrich Brasseau, who matched Richie McCaw. And we had more turnovers in that game against them because we took their strength.
Yes.
And we nullified it by getting somebody there and getting other people to run in front of Richie, not getting to the breakdown before we got there. And then with that turnover ball, we kicked it back so far so that they had to turn back and start the onslaught again. And that caused panic in the alliances.
I want to talk about the thinking that goes into that approach in a moment. But Lawrence, you played against the All Blacks. What was it like?
No, it's actually when you play the Gonzo Blacks, you don't need motivation because you know you're playing against one of the better teams in the world. So you got to be at your best as well. So by being at your best, you must be confident in your own ability to start with. But remember, when you're on there, you're representing yourself, so you got to worry about the one right in front of you. You beat him. You've done your job. So everyone's mindset is on that tip. I just beat the man in front of me. Everything is going to take care of itself. Like coaches said as well, physically, the All Blacks are not capable of keeping up with the South African physique, number one. But they've always managed to think out of the box when they play us. They do one specific thing they haven't done the whole year. And then our defenses will be like, what just happened? Because we are not reading. I think this current team is playing a lot from structure than actually trying to assess a situation that's in front of them.
Yes.
That's probably their biggest weakness at the moment. And in terms of what they know, when Eskom, when the thing hits the fan and then when trouble comes, they tend to panic and go back to what they know. And sometimes when you know, you do what you know when you're still a beginning instead of adjusting to the situation at hand. And I think their biggest weakness this weekend, the Springboks, is to make sure the All Blacks have a free rein in terms of loose ball. If they want to beat them, they have to suffocate them, keep the possession, press them into corners they don't want to, because they are actually probably, I never thought of that one until Coach PDV just opened it up. I thought they were such a great team because always attacking, but they were exploited defensively by Argentina the first game. And Argentina was actually attacking at source, right by the core, right in the middle, not wide. By the time those guys had to go back, by the time they've come so close, the Argentina have got exactly what they wanted. So South Africa needs to look at that game and exploit, actually do exactly that. I don't think they can stop us physically. And our forwards, that game is going to suit them because they're too big to be running around too much like the All Blacks are at the moment. Because at the moment, they're super fit and they like the open game. And our guys are fit to be hitting walls all day.
Yes.
So now you can't adjust to a game you never trained for. That's going to actually mentally just break them down. If they do the simple stuff physically, just close by, keep the forwards in the game, the All Blacks might be in trouble.
When we sit down, Lawrence, I'm staying with you to watch the game. There will be the national anthems and all the South Africans will probably get up and sing along. And then there's the haka. I want to ask you this. Does the haka inspire and motivate you as an opponent, or is there a little bit of intimidation factor as well?
No, it's actually more excitement. So I guess when you play against All Blacks, when you play against the All Blacks, you don't try to lift yourself from Monday.
Yes.
During the week, you focus what the team structure, you focus on me. You
focus on yourself.
I will do everything right.
Yes.
Don't get your M yet. Because once you get to M too soon, by the time you get to the game, you're fatigued.
You've got no amps left.
Yeah, you've drained yourself.
Like Eskom.
That the best time to yes, the best time is gonna make sure your generator switches on during that haka.
Yeah,
the lights comes on, and that's all you need. Once you obviously mentally prepared, physically everything is fine, but just that last switch that takes a lot of energy.
So are you saying it's almost like a trigger that this is like game time? Is that what happens?
Yes, it is a challenge. They're putting out a challenge to you, and obviously you have to accept the challenge. And that challenge has actually worked in my favor when I played the All Blacks, because every doubt I had in me of them being better than me disappeared immediately during that haka situation, because I was ready to black someone as well. So that challenge is actually good. It's nice for spectators to see. You can see the adrenaline, the pumping
up. Yes.
And you can see the opposition as well. It gets more excited. Let's get going with the game already.
The haka is intimidating.
Yes.
I can tell you that.
Yeah.
But it won't be on Saturday.
Yes.
Because of the experience our team had. I had that experience with the All Blacks. When I took a young side in 2011 to New Zealand, with a GPS that I put on my players, the anxiety levels with the experienced side were 3.
Yes.
The anxiety levels with the inexperienced side were 7.9.
Goodness.
So 7.9 in anxiety means you're already numb. You can't move.
Yes.
You know. But on Saturday, I think the Springboks are waiting for the haka more than what the All Blacks are doing, because like Lauren said, that will inspire them and will make them understand, hey, it's game on.
Fascinating. Okay. Saturday is also the Currie Cup final, and we've got with us somebody who's lifted the trophy very proudly. Kwebis Grobla, great to have you with us. Welcome. What's special about a Currie Cup final?
The toughest domestic competition in world of rugby, if it's not the toughest one. When I grew up, the EPSA Currie Cup was, I mean, it's phenomenal. You always wanted to play there and want to be part of that competition. It was a great feeling in the end, actually to win the tournament and get your hands on it. So, no, it's a massive stepping stone also. I think you get a lot of young talent coming through the EPSA Currie Cup, guys that can use that to go to the next level. And it just shows you when guys performs in the EPSA Currie Cup and they put on the green and gold and they still perform and do well,
yes,
just shows you of the quality of the rugby team.
When you were still young and you grew up, this Currie Cup were foreign to you. It belonged to Western Province.
That's still a long time ago.
He couldn't resist saying this, but let's talk about your days as a young man playing schools rugby. Randfontein, that wouldn't have been a more sort of fashionable school, I would imagine. You were at Jan Viljoen Hoër School. Was it known as a rugby school when you came in there in Standard 6? Did you feel you were already part of something that had tradition, or did you have to build that tradition?
No, it's not a traditional big rugby school. From the West Rand, there's much more bigger schools like your Monument, Florida,
yes,
and those kind of schools. I'm proud of the hometown, Randfontein, and grew up there. But I think the TV obviously had a massive influence. Those days you woke up at 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock to watch Super, I think it's Super 10 those days. And that really inspired me to watch those games. And then obviously your domestic games where your derbies is Lions, Bulls, Bulls, Province, all those games. And it was through that where the dream really started coming to life and starting to know rugby and play it. And luckily you got opportunities through the ranks and, yeah, playing in the Inder for the Lions.
We've got with us Kwebis Grobla, who had a distinguished career with the Lions. Many felt unlucky not to get a real run with the Springboks. But Kwebis, as you became a more senior player and a dressing room leader, did you feel you had a responsibility when there were young black players coming into the Lions setup to make sure that you got the best out of them? Was that something that you had experience of? Anything you can share with us about how we get the best out of all South Africans in this great game?
Yeah, I think it's when they get to that level, I think it's quite easy. And it's more guys that earn their spots. And that was main focus for us playing in this era. I mean, it's, we always get bombarded about these questions, but in the end of the day, it's 15 or 22 guys playing for each other and have a common goal. So for us, the team culture was always number one. Everybody, it doesn't matter what color your skin is, must apply by the team culture and your discipline. So I think when guys are in that line, they were always fine. Obviously, whoever steps out of that line jeopardized the whole team, and that can be, the mission can be failed. So we were very strict on the team culture.
Last question for you, Randfontein, I mean, hometown. How is rugby there? Is it flourishing? Is the club game alive? Is the school's rugby strong? Is it a hub of rugby or not?
Yeah, I think rugby, it's definitely, I won't say it's massive intensive levels, but the hype is around. The guys are supporting the Springboks, APSA Curry Cup. They massive conscience on rugby. And the guys are playing it thoroughly. I mean, from school level up, guys are playing the game they love. Not all of them will become professional rugby players, but I mean, it's a dream that they play. Just to play rugby, just to be in those four lines is massive for them. Maybe not all the talent, but I think the rugby is flowing very strongly in those veins there.
Okay. Let's take a few more comments from our panel. Kaunda,
can I just come in there?
Yes, go ahead.
Kuba said a very profound thing. He said, and opened a lot of questions, or gave me a lot of answers in my mind, why the Lions is so successful and I believe they're gonna be in contention of winning the Super Rugby trophy next year. But what he said is that they created a team culture, and it's nothing to do with personal culture. They created a team culture. So anybody who comes into that team, they have to adapt to the team culture, and if not, they open himself to be excluded.
Yes.
And that is so, so important. But while in our country we have a rugby culture that doesn't exist, we don't create our own culture so that everybody can fit into that culture who become part of that team.
So there's a tweet here from our colleague Sandile. We've put some pictures up on Twitter. You can have a look. He says, John looks like a ref with a scrum half, Peter de Villiers, and two props just before the start of a scrum. So I'm not sure what to make of that. I'm not sure which ref he means either, because refs are not always the best loved people in rugby.
No. So we can do without them.
Yes. And how would you run that one, by the way? Oh, it's okay. Now let's get Kaunda. You wanted to talk about something.
Yeah, I think once you get to that level, I'm talking now Curry Cup, Super Rugby, Springboks, as a player, you must be well aware that not everything can just be handed to you on a platter. Mm-hmm. You need to work very, very, very hard to get selected, and not only to be selected, but to stay up there. I remember when I was coming from, there was a time I was with the Cheetahs and moved around, and then I joined the Lions. Unfortunately, I only got a chance to play at Vodacom Cup level, never further, but I did get a chance to train with the Super Rugby squad. And I think a guy like Baywatch, Kobus Hrobler, he's, they call him Baywatch, I don't know, he'll explain that later.
Or not.
his work ethic, I think for me, is what really stood out. And he was a loose forward. I was a loose forward at the time as well. And I just thought that for me, that was the basis. If you want to make it, this is how hard you have to work. And it's quite important, you know, that we are sitting here and we are talking transformation and we are talking about opportunities. But once the youngsters get into those squads, they really, really, really need to work hard. And they will have senior players there that set the tone in terms of work ethic to be there.
So Peter, I want you to come in on this, because I want to pick up on what Nick and Lizzie were saying about selection for representative teams, age group teams, district teams, and so on. From what you know of over many, many years of coaching, and I want you maybe to share this with parents who've got youngsters playing rugby now. How important is it that you make those teams? And how much of a setback is it if you don't? Presumably you've got talent. Some of them came up the regular ladder as expected, but there must have been people who bypassed many of the steps and suddenly emerged 17, 18 as contenders. But you're the coach. You tell us what you've seen over the years.
I don't think people, if they don't make a team, I don't think they failed.
Yes.
They only have now, they know where the bar is for themselves so they can do better. Mm-hmm. And that what bothers people is when there's injustice.
Mm-hmm.
And what we know through the school system is that schools are working hard to get their teachers into a position where they can represent that union as a selector. So now they use that opportunity to market the school too. Then they keep better guys out of the team, so and select their, give their vote to the teams, the boys at their schools, so that people now can, the better rugby players now understand, I have to go to that school if I want to make it. That is exactly what's happening. The subtleness of our people. I said when money comes into the rugby game,
yes,
it will go down the drain. But I think if we can take people out of this game, it will actually work much better for us too, because the people are running their own agenda,
yes,
most of the times, and they don't understand that I never coached a rugby player in my life yet, and I will never. I try to coach the person in, yes, the rugby player, because there's warmth, he's got a heart, he's got feelings, and he's got dreams. And you don't shatter his dreams, he has to shatter his own dreams. But when you set the standard and you know why you didn't select him, he can feel free to come see me anytime, because I will never have an excuse.
Yes.
I will always have a reason.
An explanation.
And why I didn't make it. But the one thing players must understand too, and that Kaunda just said, that every coach wants to be successful. So if you're the best player, he will never leave you out of the team, because you can help him to become successful. So when a coach drops you, you know you're not good enough. But it doesn't mean that you can't become good enough.
Yes,
it's just
for now.
Go work very, very hard. Go ask, what should I work on? Where do you think is my shortcomings? And if you can do that, I'm telling you now, this game will transform immediately.
Lawrence, I want to ask you this. Do we define too narrowly the path to success? And let me tell you what I mean by that we start maybe with boys 13, 14, 15 saying, you're in the provincial team, you're not. And when people don't get picked at that age group level, we stop looking. In other words, we say, okay, we've got our 30 boys, we've got our 60 boys, we've got perhaps a pool of 100, and anything outside of that, because we're the experts, there can't be any other talent that we haven't found. Do you think that we think too narrowly as a country, saying, okay, this is the system, and once you drop out of the system, you dropped out because you're not good enough? In fact, maybe we fail to spot your potential. Any thoughts on that? Is there talent out there that gets missed in the, for example, the Coca-Cola week?
No, certainly, man, there's a lot of talent out there, actually too much talent in South Africa. And then sometimes we tend to miss the core of the talent because we're too focused on the cream of the core, that we actually look after those. And if that cream happens to evaporate, and then we want to develop new cream, but then we actually miss the core of the players that could have actually popped through if you selected a bigger pool of players and actually put them through a system, criteria, a standard, where you basically, when you start, let's say first Craven Week, as a coach of the Craven Week, you get given a job, but you start putting criteria down. This is how fast I want my winger. This, yes, is how strong I want my prop. When you select those talented stars, when you see them, then you put them to a system where you measure them. Saying, okay, how strong is he? How big is he? And obviously he's got a weakness here, but I like how he plays. Now let me work on the weakness while I'm actually looking after other group as well, because you know what you want out of him, what he can bring to you as well. And my problem at the moment, I'm going to go right to the cream though, is that my biggest problem with the selection of the Springbok team at the moment. We're so focused on satisfying only the people we selected first that we're actually neglecting number three, number four. People actually, that needs to be, there's number one, there's number two, there's number three. I think our national coach has probably got number one and number two. No number three or number four. What of those number two and three, number one and two gets injured? What does it do now? That's when it actually is to now pray for players to recover in time in order to make the national team, which for me, first of all, is wrong. You're not representing individuals there. You're not representing yourself. You're representing a nation. If you're going to treat a team as your pet project, it's for me a problem. You need to prevent the country. You need to have enough players. You don't have a limitation as to how many players you can select. You can select as many as you like, and you got to make sure all those players, 1 to 4, in those order, actually are meeting each other. The margins are very small. So when one player steps wrong, yes, once, it doesn't need second invitation. Listen, you didn't do well the last game. Let's see what this one can do. That's going to create a competition within the team as well, so players know when they perform, I'm going to stay. I don't perform, just tickets, Baba. Now when someone else is in line, know that you're throwing them away. Mm. You're just reminding them again because you started. Mm. You didn't do so well, go to the bench.
Yeah.
Come show to me again why I made you my number one. Then if you can't do that, then unfortunately number three is stepping into the number two.
Yes.
I think that system is not existent in the country. And the team environment, even the players, I had the opportunity, I won't drop names though, I had the opportunity to talk with the fringe players that didn't make the World Cup squad.
Mm.
And the sense of frustration and disappointment in unable to represent their country, not because the lack of adequacy or ability, but the opinion of the people that are in power of a certain individual or a certain thing, opinion, not on your talent, but the opinion, what they think.
Mm.
It's actually is a situation when they get based on, which I find it very difficult. We all go through the same systems. You do fitness, you do your basic, your strength. We go through the same channel, but then when you get selected, where does opinion come in? Because there's no criteria for opinion. He's got his own opinion, I've got my own, he's got his own.
Mm.
So if there's a criteria in how you select players and the coach has got a game plan, then if a player is good enough to be selected, I'm sure it's good enough to be taught to fit in a certain gameplay.
So you say we're going to miss Yaku Krio Saturday? I say yes.
No, I would agree because Yaku Krio is actually, I had a chance to play with him. He had a lot of hamstring problems then, but he was a youngster. I mean, Baywatch as well, I noticed he came past, he was a protege. He was a youngster coming, could see he was hungry, but I think he was not developed enough yet. You know, his body, his heart and his mind was there, but his body was not there with him yet. It's only now that he actually is at his, you know, optimum body condition and is very fit. Unfortunately, not to have made the Springbok team.
Okay, we're right at the end, but Peter, I want to ask you the last question. If our rugby is to become more inclusive of all South Africans, do we need to change the style of our play?
You know,
or at least consider it.
You know, the Lions has showed us that they didn't change the style of our play, but they've grown with the trends of where world rugby is going. And to do that, you need a coach who understands the game. If you got a game plan set in stone, is to protect you as a coach, because anybody who step out of the plan, you can then pull him back. But when the player does what he sees and he plays to the best of his potential and ability, and he has a reason why he's done it, he will outsmart you when you sit across him and talk to him. So I don't think that our coaches are really ready for the challenge to take our rugby players to the next level, because they are a protected species at the moment too. Like the referees, like you.
Which is a topic for a whole other day. We're going to have to leave it there, everybody. But can I just thank our panel and, of course, everybody else who joined us here tonight. Peter de Villiers, thanks for giving us your time. Lawrence Sephaka, Kaunda Ntunja. Huge weekend of rugby coming up. But beyond that, as we said right at the start of the show, the huge challenge, however well we do in the World Cup, of making this game and indeed all other games in our society as inclusive as possible.
And that is all we have for you in this week's episode of Kaya Sport TV. Before we go, lots and lots of luck for the Boks as they go up against the All Blacks in the semi-finals of the Rugby World Cup. We can only hope that in the next 4 years at the next World Cup, when the Boks take on the All Blacks, the team will be a little more inclusive. But until next time, it's goodbye.